I suspect most of my technical questions are answered in the appendix, so I'm just going to hold off on those. But I do have one thought that came to mind. As you talked about earlier, what's in scope and out of scope, one of the things that's out of scope is looking at the way MFLs have been set on other water bodies. But we have two MFLs here. To what extent is comparison between these two? Should I fully isolate, or am I allowed to say, hey, in the middle you did this, on the upper you did this?
Well, I have an opinion on that, but
I'm interested in it.
I think we want the best country about the view of the if it's an aesthetic difference, then I think that would be a little bit different.
Yeah, there's
a substantive difference in how the work is done.
I think the tip more is, you know, if a different water management district does their river MFLs in a totally different way.
No, I understand that.
Yeah, I mean, you'll see a lot of similarities between the upper and middle, but yeah, I think part of the intent is for you to, you know, weigh in on some of the differences there as well.
I finished reading the upper Suwannee MFL report and hadn't spent much time in the report, and I started to formulate some questions. Probably don't want to go into those now, maybe by the first, the next public meeting, virtual meeting. At the risk of wondering why you don't do this similar to other water management districts, especially the Southwest, some of your flows are important seasonally for the sturgeon spawning, but you don't block this into flow blocks. You don't do the high flow periods, low flow periods, like what Southwest does. What's your thinking on that?
Yeah, I mean, I think those decisions were made a while back.
Yeah.
Frankly, I don't know how much the block approach was considered.
Yeah.
That'd be something we could consider. I think what we have done with considering specific months and kind of limiting the analysis to those, it's kind of an analogous approach.
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm thinking of. I haven't gotten input enough to really understand that, but the minimum flow would apply. I'm not asking this question. Would the minimum flow apply just during the salmon sturgeon spawning season? Would that be the only time that it would have to meet that the flow would have to be met in order to ensure the spawning or fish passage?
Yeah, I would say the way we're thinking of this is, you know, being from a water supply planning perspective, where really the water use that's affecting the Suwannee River right now is groundwater withdrawals.
Yeah.
And, you know, the way those are permitted and everything, are not done in a way that they're able to be cut back in certain months. So what we would anticipate is applying that whatever that limiting flow amount is throughout the whole year. Because that's the mechanism I think we have to be able to manage the withdrawals that will be caused in those changes.
Okay, really we're only doing the low flow periods that you have a problem anyway, right?
Correct. Again, I mean, we do have water shortage orders and things that can happen in low flow periods, but we're kind of using this, I think, more to say, and under all conditions, really, including those lower flows, what amount could be taken out all the time, so you still wouldn't violate that metric and cause significant harm, even in a lower flow period.
So at some point, you're going to, I guess as part of the recovery strategy, you're going to develop some kind of a mechanism where you would find out, using the NetSeg model, you would know whose withdrawals are most affecting the river, and you could somehow curtail those withdrawals if they were causing the river to go below the minimum flow. I mean, that's one of the first things I saw is none of that is in the reports now. strategy?
Yeah, I mean, if any of these gauges were in recovery, yeah, I think that would then how to get the flow back up to where, you know, the MFL would be handled at that point. And I wouldn't speculate at this point, you know, how that would be done.
Yeah, I guess that's really where the rubber meets the road is how you're going to do that, how you're going to manage the system. Because as you say, it's not like an in-stream withdrawal where you can just tell them to cut back their pumping. You have impacts on the river from a huge area from groundwater pumping. Mm-hmm. And you have to figure out how you are going to manage all of that. And then another question about permitting in the future. So, and again, I guess this is probably part of the recovery strategy also, but in terms of issuing additional groundwater withdrawal permits, that's part of the recovery strategy for
the components that you're speaking about are a couple steps down the line.
Yeah.
Making sure we have a technically valid MFL.
Right.
And they have their own set of statutes and rules that guide how that process is conducted. So I would say for the purposes of this peer review, the focus would be on the technical correctness of the work that was done here to establish the